Almost 3 years after releasing on consoles, the upgraded and enhanced version of Grand Theft Auto V has finally arrived on PC. And this free upgrade introduces several new graphical features, including ray tracing effects, support for new upscalers and anti-aliasing options, and more. And recently I asked what you wanted to see for this new version, and most of you voted for a complete breakdown of every graphic setting. So in this video, that's exactly what we are going to do. But before diving into the settings, let's first go over what's visually new in this enhanced version, aside from ray tracing. And the first noticeable improvement is the enhanced special effects when using the highest setting. And as you can see here, fire, smoke, and other particle effects look significantly better in the enhanced version compared to the legacy one. The second change is in grass and foliage. Notice here how the enhanced version has slightly more foliage with better shadows and lighting, and the grass placement differs from the legacy version. Finally, in this comparison, we can see that the enhanced version features a more intense bloom effect along with improved ambient occlusion. And when it comes to performance, this new version is more demanding, and the performance gap varies depending on the scene. Sometimes it's a minor difference like here, while in most cases it's more noticeable. Additionally, both versions suffer from frame pacing issues at high frame rates, with the legacy version exhibiting occasional freezes, and the enhanced version showing spikes when reaching around 150 fps, as you can see here in this example. In addition to the visual upgrades, the enhanced version comes with direct storage support, promising faster loading times when using an SSD. But I did notice a bit of a regression when loading into the story mode from the main menu, where the legacy version actually loads faster than the enhanced one. However, the real benefit of direct storage becomes evident when trying to load the same save while already in the game. And as you can see here, the enhanced version loads the save significantly faster than the legacy one. So let's move on to ray tracing, starting with RT shadows. And here, when switching between the standard shadow maps and the RT options, we can see that the RT shadows excel at capturing both close and distant objects, especially on ultra. However, in this scene, a major limitation becomes apparent. Due to the excessive contact hardening, enabling ray tracing actually removes a lot of shadow details. This is evident with the shadows of the Ferris wheel and the roller coaster track. And in this case, the softest standard shadows produce more accurate and visually appealing results, in my opinion. Additionally, due to either a low ray count or a low quality denoiser, these RT shadows, similar to other RT effects as we'll see later, exhibit no noticeable noise, even at native 1440p with DLAA, and performance-wise, enabling RT shadows can cost up to 11%. Moving on to ray traced reflections. This RT effect significantly enhances the visual fidelity by rendering accurate reflections across the game's glossy surfaces. And as you can see here, increasing this setting extends the distance at which objects are considered for reflections. However, similar to RT shadows, there are some limitations. Many reflective surfaces, such as vehicle rearview mirrors and bodies of water, do not receive RT reflections and instead rely on cube maps and planar reflections, which can be distracting. Additionally, as we saw with RT shadows, these RT reflections exhibit noticeable noise as shown here. And performance-wise, on high RT reflections reduces performance by around 6%, while very high and ultra bring that impact to 14% and 16% respectively. However, in this scene, the performance hit is more significant, with 10% on high, 23% on very high, and 25% on ultra. Next, we have Ray Trace Global Illumination, which out of all the RTE effects, delivers the most substantial visual improvements. This effect simulates bounced lighting by realistically brightens areas that don't receive direct light and reflects the color of the surfaces that the light interacts with. This results in a massive visual improvement over the game standard lighting. However, similar to RTE shadows and reflections, this RTE effect also suffers from noticeable noise, as you can see here. When it comes to the visual differences between the options, we can see that increasing the setting extends the distance at which RTGI is applied. And performance-wise, this is the most demanding ray tracing effect. Using high or very high results in a performance hit of around 16%, and going up to ultra drastically increases the cost, reducing performance by around 43% in this scene. The last ray tracing effect is ray trace ambient occlusion, and visually I think this is the least noticeable one. While you can see the difference here when switching between these shots, during normal gameplay you're likely not going to notice it, and similar to the previous RTE settings, increasing this one extends the distance and the number of objects that receive RTAO, and performance wise going from HBAO to high RTAO costs around 9%, to very high around 11%, and to ultra around 18%. And finally, we have this BVH quality setting, which has a limited visual impact on most RTE effects, as you can see here with RTE reflections. However, for RTE shadows, it has a noticeably greater impact on the number of objects that receive this effect. And in this scene, going from high to very high has a small cost of around 4%. So generally for ray tracing, I think RTGI is a must, and if you have a capable GPU, I highly recommend enabling it with high or very high. RTE reflections also provide a noticeable visual upgrade, but they are the noisiest of all RTE effects. And if you want to enable RTE reflections, I recommend high, as it provides a noticeable visual improvement over the standard planar and cube map reflections without the significant performance hit of very high or ultra. RTE shadows, on the other hand, are not worth the extra cost. The implementation has major drawbacks, and in most situations, the standard softer shadows provide better results. Lastly, RTAO has the least noticeable visual impact, making it the least important RTE effect to enable. Also, keep in mind that the performance impact of ray tracing varies depending on your CPU and your GPU's RTE capabilities. If your GPU has weak RTE performance, or you have a weaker CPU, you might see an even greater performance hit than what I have shown when enabling ray tracing. Let's move on to image quality and the new upscaling and anti-aliasing options. And here at 1440p with the quality mode, we can see that both DLSS and FSR3 suffer from noticeable shimmering issues, but FSR3 appears softer and struggles with ghosting and severe pixelation on fast-moving objects. On the other hand, TAA and FSR1 are not even on the same level as DLSS and FSR3, and they look significantly worse, which explains their higher performance. At native resolution, FSR3 looks much better with a significant reduction in pixelation, though ghosting remains an issue. DLAA looks softer and struggles to retain the details on this moving wheel, while TAA still looks blurry, and unlike when upscaling, it doesn't provide the same level of performance gain. So overall, if you can't use DLSS, FSR3, despite all its issues, remains a much better option than TAA. And if you have an RTX GPU, I highly recommend overriding the DLSS transformer model with preset K using NVIDIA Profile Inspector. This will provide a sharper image, better anti-aliasing, and improved texture clarity compared to the default DLSS. Yes, there will be a performance cost, but you can compensate by using a lower upscaling tier, like here where the quality DLSS4 delivers a much better image than the old DLAA while still offering significantly higher performance. Moving on to shader quality, this one has a major impact on the game's visuals. It affects parallax occlusion mapping, which is only enabled when using very high, as you can see here, and also improves the accuracy of the lighting in certain scenarios, like this sunset scene. Performance-wise, I tested this setting across multiple scenes with parallax occlusion mapping, like here, or the lighting accuracy, and I couldn't measure any significant performance impact. Therefore, I recommend leaving this one at very high. Let's move on to texture quality. This is an area I wish Rockstar had improved to better complement the ray traced lighting, because even with very high, the texture quality and assets don't hold up particularly well. As for VRAM usage, 8GB is more than enough for very high textures at 1440p even with ray tracing enabled. And to keep textures clearer and sharper, I recommend setting anisotropic filtering to 16x, as this shouldn't cause any noticeable performance impact. Moving on to particles quality. As I mentioned before, the game features a new and enhanced particle effects that are only enabled when using Ultra, as you can see here. These effects look significantly better, adding a noticeable improvement to the visuals. But of course, this comes at a massive performance cost. In my testing, I measured around a 16% performance drop when going from very high to Ultra. That being said, it's hard to justify downgrading to the original particles. After all, we are playing the enhanced version of the game, so I generally recommend keeping the setting at Ultra. However, if performance drops during intense combat scenarios or explosions become an issue, then consider lowering it to very high. Next, we have tessellation. This setting adds more depth and polygonal details to certain objects, primarily affecting trees and palm trunks. And in terms of performance, it has a negligible impact, so I recommend keeping it at very high. Next, I want to talk about water quality alongside reflection quality, as both contribute to a significant performance issue in this enhanced version. So let's start with water quality. This one is straightforward and affects the quality of water surfaces and water simulation effects, in addition to reflections on bodies of water. And there is a little to no visual difference between high, very high, and ultra, and they also perform the same with around 6% cost when coming from normal. On the other hand, reflection quality controls the quality of both cube map and planar reflections, and using very high costs around 4%, while going up to ultra drops performance by around 8%. Now, the issue I mentioned earlier occurs when going underwater, as you can see here, where the performance dips significantly, and both settings are the main culprits, because this happens when using water quality above normal while also setting reflection quality above high. Now, unless you spent a lot of time underwater in this game, I recommend keeping water quality at ultra and reflection quality at very high. However, until Rockstar fixes this issue, whenever you plan to go underwater, make sure to lower either water quality to normal or reflection quality to high to prevent major performance drops. Moving on to grass quality, this one simply adjusts the density and raw distance of grass and ground vegetation, with both very high and ultra adding shadows to these elements. And while ultra grass quality now doesn't have the same massive performance hit as before, it's still quite demanding, because here going from normal to high costs around 8%, to very high 12%, and to ultra around 18%. So for this one, I recommend high or very high. Let's move on to lighting quality. The setting is new to the enhanced version, and according to its description, it should adjust the lighting quality of the sun, moon, and local lights. However, after spending a considerable amount of time trying to spot any visual differences between normal and ultra, I couldn't find any. It's possible that I am looking in the wrong place, or this setting simply isn't functioning correctly. Either way, I recommend leaving it at ultra, since it doesn't seem to have any noticeable impact on performance. Let's move on to the shadow settings, starting with shadow quality and high resolution shadows. There is one key change in this enhanced version compared to the legacy one when it comes to shadows. Vehicle headlights and local lights shadows now remain enabled even when using normal or high, as you can see here. And looking at performance, going from normal to high shadow quality costs around 2%, while going up to very high raises the cost to 8%. However, enabling high resolution shadows results in a significant 13% performance hit when coming from very high. Because of this, I don't recommend using high resolution shadows. Instead, I suggest taking advantage of the soft shadow setting, which can help produce and hide shadow aliasing, as you can see here, without causing a significant performance drop. Another setting that can influence shadow aliasing is extended shadow distance. This increases the draw distance of shadows, allowing more of them to be visible on distant objects. And as you can see here, it doesn't have any major performance impact. However, it does come with a drawback that I previously overlooked and didn't mention in my last video. When set above 0 out of 10 bars, this setting starts showing aliasing in mid-range shadow cascades. And unfortunately, this issue is still present in the enhanced version. Because of this, I highly recommend keeping this setting at 0. And lastly, we have long shadows, which as we saw last time, doesn't have any significant performance impact, so I recommend keeping it enabled. Moving on to post effects, this one controls the quality of the new bloom effect, and going from normal to high enables bloom, while going further slightly increases its intensity. Additionally, using very high adds a subtle depth of field effect on distant objects, as you can see here. And surprisingly, this setting has a major performance impact, especially at higher levels, with a 10% cost when going from normal to very high and 16% when going to ultra. Because of this, I recommend keeping this one at high, but if you don't like the bloom effect, drop it to normal. And I noticed something strange when it comes to the in-game depth of field effect setting. Throughout my testing, I always found that high consistently performs better than normal. And if we take a look at this scene, we can see that high has more artifacts and lower quality depth of field, which explains the performance difference. And I don't have any recommendations for this one, since it's mostly a matter of personal preference. But if you like it, keep it on normal to get the best quality depth of field. Next we have ambient occlusion, and this is another area where the enhanced version differs from the legacy version. The old SSAO is gone, replaced by two new techniques, HBAO and SSDO. And visually, SSDO has a darker and more intense ambient occlusion effect. But because of this, it suffers from noticeable stability issues compared to HBAO, as you can see here. And in terms of performance, both options cost around 4%. So for this one, I recommend HBAO, as it provides a more stable ambient occlusion. Let's move on to the population setting, starting with population density. This one adjusts the number of pedestrians and vehicles, as you can see here, and it primarily affects CPU performance. Here I measured an average performance cost of around 6% when going from 0 out of 10 to 5 out of 10, and 11% when going up to 10 out of 10. As for population variety, it doesn't seem to have any noticeable performance impact. However, despite this, I recommend keeping both settings at 5 out of 10. And if you're still having CPU performance issues, consider lowering them further. And lastly, we have the level of detail settings. Let's first examine distance scaling. This one adjusts the level of detail for distant objects, as you can see here. And it doesn't seem to have any significant impact on CPU performance, even when increasing it from 0 out of 10 to 10 out of 10. There is also the extended distance scaling setting, which pushes the level of detail even further. And performance-wise, going from 0 out of 10 to 5 out of 10 costs around 5%, while going up to 10 out of 10 increases that to 9%. And the last setting here is high detail streaming while flying, which as its name indicates allows for higher level of detail when flying, as you can see here. And it's quite challenging to measure the performance impact of this one, but overall it doesn't seem to come with a significant cost. So generally for these settings, I recommend keeping distance scaling at 10 out of 10 while lowering extended distance scaling to 5 out of 10 to stay on the safe side. As for high detail streaming while flying, it's a situational setting, so I suggest keeping it enabled. And just like with population settings, if you are having CPU performance issues, be sure to lower the LOD settings even further. So given everything we've discussed so far, these are my recommended settings for Grand Theft Auto 5 Enhanced. Now let's compare the performance of optimized and max settings at 1440p DLAA. And to keep this comparison fair, I disabled RTAO and RT shadows on both sides. And as you can see here, optimized RT offers an average performance improvement of around 87% over the maximum RT preset. And if we take ray tracing out of the equation, the performance improvement isn't as significant as before, but we still see about a 32% gain when going from max to optimize settings. And with that, we arrive at the end. Thank you so much for watching and for your time. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell for future videos, and hopefully I'll see you all in the next one.